All right. So you stole my question. You asked, you know, how many people do continuous integration here? Specifically, how many people work with Jenkins? All right, good. So you did come to the right talk. So Jenkins, by default, or at least according to the manual, is recommended to run on-premise. And it comes with some limitations, some restrictions. So we'll talk to you about how to mitigate some of those issues by moving into the cloud and talk to further results of that. I'm here today for the high-level overview. I'm a technical evangelist. JJ is my name. Bhagyashri is our DevOps expert, so she'll be taking it on. When we dive into details, I will give you a slight overview of our company, as he said. So Irdeto does business to business, which is why you have probably not seen our logo before. We service about 400 customers worldwide. We secure digital platforms. We started out in pay TV, meaning that when you pay for your TV subscription, specifically sports or whatever package you pay more for, we make sure that you're able to see that and your neighbor who doesn't pay cannot. Second, when video is stolen, we put things inside to make sure that we can track how it has leaked. So that's initially where our business got started about 50 years ago. So we have offices worldwide. What I wanted to stress today is that we are a software development company. About 70% of the people employed at Irdeto work in software development, engineering, and research. So just to touch on a couple of topics, we don't just do security for TV and movies. We secure games, online games, multiplayer games, as well as cars. So you've probably seen some talks over the course of yesterday and today about security and hacks, and I saw in the IoT space there were quite some presentations on that. We make sure that that doesn't happen, and when it happens, we know how. Right? Yeah. So DevOps is an integral part of our deployments, and we've seen some issues with the traditional setup of Jenkins, which Bhagyashri will now say more about.
Yep. Thank you, JJ. Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining. So in this picture, we all see a lot of keywords around continuous integration. So what is continuous integration? I'm going to quote the Wikipedia definition of continuous integration. Continuous integration is the process of, is the practice of merging all developers' working copy to the shared mainline, and we do this activity several times in a day. So continuous integration is also known as CI, and there are a lot of challenging aspects around continuous integration. So let's start with security. So when source code of any organization is one of the most important and valuable asset, which is intellectual property of a company. And source code is going to sit in CI system. So security of CI infrastructure becomes very crucial and important when we have CI system working in the organization. Second point, single point of failure. So when we have CI infrastructure set up in an organization, we need to know what is the single point of failure in our CI system. And if we know what is that, then we need to have a plan B to mitigate that single point of failure. High availability. So when system is running in the production and it's customer facing, so high availability is really crucial in those scenarios. Scalability. So scalability allows continuous integration system to cope up with increasing load. We all know that load in software development is spiky in nature. So when there is a release, we are all busy in coding and submitting code. So we have different kinds of load during release and during weekends, during nights. So our system has to be highly scalable to cope up with that load. Then coming to the data recovery. So I would like to call data recovery as automatic recovery, as a self-healing. So self-healing allows a system to recover back automatically on its own, and it doesn't need any human intervention. So self-healing, it's like self-regulating. You discover there is a problem and recover back to normal state or a designed state. And the last, but very important, which is backup. So backup is always a second level of defense in an infrastructure. When drastically everything goes wrong, then somebody has to intervene manually, recover the backup, and resurrect the system back to normal. So backup is really important, though it is at the end. So in the subsequent slides, we are going to see in detail about each of these challenging aspects. OK, so this is our rough agenda for today's presentation. We will be summarizing what is Jenkins is. Then we will see how Jenkins look like on-premise and in cloud. And then we will see how the implementation of Jenkins can be automated using Amazon Web Services CloudFormation in this case. Then we will see how this infrastructure can be further improved and security can be hardened. And later we will also show a live demo of where we will introduce a failure in an infrastructure and we see the infrastructure coming back normally in a couple of minutes. And at the end we can take a couple of questions. So many of you already raised hands that you already using Jenkins in your organization. So let's recapitulate about Jenkins, what it is and why it is so popular. Yeah, so in continuous integration ecosystem, we have quite many tools. So to mention a few, there is TeamCT, Travis, QuickBuild, and Jenkins. But why Jenkins is so popular? So Jenkins is first thing, it's open source. It comes along with the MIT license. And it has got a vibrant community, as we all know. You Google for anything, you get a lot of information about the troubleshooting tips and things like that. Jenkins also come up along with the 1,000+ plugins, so which makes any software development project to adapt Jenkins very easily. And not only the available Jenkins plugin, but it also allows to develop your own plugins for developers. So it's always flexible to adapt or develop your own plugins and use it in your infrastructure. So this makes a very good fit for any software development project. And that's why Jenkins is very popular release management tool, which is very crucial. Without it, it's very hard to imagine any software development project without a good infrastructure of CI. So some of us are already very familiar with Jenkins, but I would still like to touch a basic terminology so that we all are on the same page. So let's start with, So Jenkins 1.x and Jenkins 2.x. There is a small difference between Jenkins 1.x and 2.x in terms of terminologies. So node is any server which is running in Jenkins infrastructure, which can be slave or master. Then master is a machine which is interfaced to the user and which is the main server in Jenkins infrastructure and which holds all the configuration. And then master is common in Jenkins 1.x and 2.x. Slave is a machine who actually runs the job. So master gets the request and it gets delegated to slave and it gets run. Slave terminology is coming from Jenkins 1.x. And then agent. So agent is coming from Jenkins 2.x. So agent is exactly same as slave, but it's just a terminology change from 1.x to 2.x. And the last one is executor. So executor is a basic building block which allows a build to run on slave or agent or any node. We can run build on master, slave, or agent, but it is always recommended that build should be run only on slave or agent. Because master, you want to keep always responsive to the end user. We don't want to keep master busy. So it's always recommended that slave and agent should be used for build. So next slide, please. Yeah, so this picture gives the Jenkins master-slave standard architecture. By design, Jenkins have only one master machine running. It has multiple slaves machine running. And all these slaves can be configured depending on OS platform which you are looking for. For example, in this diagram, we have Windows, Linux, or Apple OS X, but it depends completely on the project requirement. So basically, Jenkins master get any build request, and it gets delegated to any of the slave which is very suitable for that particular build. So the Jenkins, what is the flexibility here? So Jenkins slave can be actually configured according to the project requirement. Let's say there is very simple, lightweight job. You don't need very powerful machine. So your Jenkins slave can be configured with a very basic configuration, T2 micro instance or small, whatever fits for your configuration or that particular job, it can be configured. So this allows the flexibility. And at the same time, if you have something long duration, heavy performance test running, then you need a powerful machine. So in that case, you can upgrade your machine and have your slave configured to run that job. So it allows the flexibility to configure the slave or agent according to your job requirement. So by doing that, we can always save some cost. You don't need to always have a powerful machine for all the jobs. So this is the main benefit. And then second point is you can label your slaves and agent. So you can always restrict which job to get run on which slave. So this allows also the labeling. As we see in the Jenkins architecture, master is the only one machine which is holding all the configuration, backup, and all the build requests, and which is the only interface to the end user. So this makes master as a single point of failure. And in the subsequent slide, we are going to see how can we avoid master being a single point of failure. So we can set up Jenkins on-premise, which is a traditional way. So let's have a look at first how Jenkins look like when it is running on-premise. So this is a typical architecture of Jenkins running on-premise. There are different ways to set it up, but for this example, we are using a typical architecture set up as a Jenkins running on-premise. In this diagram, as you say, we can only have a Jenkins one master running, and we have four virtual machines. So point to note here is that we have four restricted fixed number of slaves. So I can handle only four build requests at a time in this architecture. And in this typical example, we have source control system. It can sit in cloud or it can sit in on-premise, depending on. In this example, it is sitting on-premise. And whole this setup is available only on company intranet, because this is something inside your organization, in-house setup, and it's available only on company intranet. So this is a simple architecture, what it looks like on-premise. So with this architecture, we see some of the risk and problems, what we are going to see in the next slide. So the first thing, we have only fixed number of slaves. So it restricts the number of builds coming and the number of builds which are served by Jenkins. We already discussed that load in the software development is spiky in nature. We are close to release. Developers are very busy in coding, and code submission is happening very frequently. But no developer wants to stay in the queue to just test something. So with the number of, if we have fixed number of agents or slaves, we are really restricted and it doesn't become that efficient. So this is a one risk we see with on-premise Jenkins. Then second one is downtime. So let's say it's finally a machine. So physical failure or any software failure can happen in the Jenkins infrastructure, what we have. So first thing, it doesn't, we don't get to know automatically that, okay, something went wrong in your Jenkins infrastructure. So when somebody tries to run build, oh, the agent is not getting picked up. Then you find a problem, and then you look, you try to identify what went wrong. So this is a process, identifying a problem, and then you troubleshoot, you try to find a solution. So this may take number of minutes, number of hours, number of days. So here we get some kind of downtime, and during that time, our Jenkins infrastructure is unavailable to the developers. So this is one of the drawbacks we see. And then last but very important is manual setup. So when something is getting set up in-house, somebody has to really know the steps very well. If it is not documented, somebody has to study and get those steps in place and then do the things one by one. It can be a little bit automated. For example, provisioning of any server can be automated using Puppet or Chef. But still, there are some things you need to do manually. Getting the hardware's OS installation and those kind of things, running the backup. So these are the things which becomes cumbersome and they're prone to error. And imagine if these things are happening again and again, then nobody wants to do this manual setup again and again. And if it is undocumented knowledge, then it's a nightmare. So when something goes wrong, then it's always time taking and effort to get the system back and make it available again back to the development team. So in the subsequent slides, we will try to see if we try to find answers to some of these problems by setting up Jenkins in the cloud. So setting up Jenkins in the cloud is a little bit tricky. And today we are going to share what we learned, what exercise we did during last year, and share that knowledge so that if it is helpful for you guys also. So let's see how Jenkins look like in the cloud. So this diagram shows Jenkins architecture in Amazon Web Services. So before I go into detail of the architecture, I would like to a little bit give quick overview of cloud terms, what we are using in this diagram, so that we all are on the same page. So in the right side, if you see, there is a dotted line which depicts VPC, so which is a virtual private cloud. So to spin up any infrastructure in any environment, you need first thing as a network. So VPC provides isolated network in your account where you can spin up your infrastructure. So VPC is the very basic thing to, before spinning up any machine. Then inside VPC, you are going to have different kind of subnets, regions, availability zones. So region will be like isolated geographical area where you want to set it up in Europe, in US region. So it depends on your need. And once you have all these things set up, then you have Elastic Compute Cloud, which is EC2 instances we are using for Jenkins Master and Jenkins Slaves. As you see, Jenkins Slaves are not fixed in number. They are on demand, so it can be scaled. We will be seeing that in detail in the subsequent slides. So Jenkins Master is also using auto-scaling group, which allows to keep check of healthy instance periodically and make sure that we always have one Jenkins Master running in the configuration. In front of Jenkins Master, as it is interface to the end user, so we have Elastic Load Balancer, which is sitting in front of Jenkins Master, and which keeps doing the health check automatically and periodically, and make sure that healthy instance is always running. And to make this load balancer available, we are using Route 53 domain name system, which is pointing to the Elastic Load Balancer address. So this is how the Jenkins is sitting inside AWS cloud. And at the source control system. So source control system can be on-premise or it can be on cloud. In this example, we are using source control system also on the cloud, which is sitting in completely different VPC, which is on a completely different network. And both VPCs can be paired using the VPC pairing so that they both can talk to each other. And in the Jenkins setup, as you see in the right side, we have S3 bucket, which is simple storage service from Amazon, and Elastic Block Storage Store, which is EBS. So these two are very important things we are using here in this architecture, which are two-tier backup. So first backup is Elastic Block Store, which gives encrypted backup and which is persistent. So this can be attached to EC2 instance, in this case to Jenkins Master. And when Jenkins Master goes down, the EBS, it's still persistent. It still keeps the data. When something goes wrong, let's say along with EBS, then we have second level of backup, which is S3 bucket. So we are using duplicity as a synchronization software to keep up all the Jenkins configuration regularly to the S3 bucket. So this is like second level of defense. If something goes wrong in the first level, we always have a second thing in place. And the backup in S3 bucket is also encrypted. So this is how the architecture of Jenkins in the cloud looks like. We are going to see what are the advantages of this setup and see them in detail, how did we achieve them. So there are quite many advantages of running Jenkins in the cloud, but we are going to, I would like to highlight three of them first. So self-healing. So self-healing allows the system to recover it automatically on its own without any human intervention. Then high scalability. So to keep up with the increasing load and decreasing load, you need to have a scalable system. So highly scalable, this is second benefit, is really important we see using Jenkins on the cloud. And then last one is security. Security is always a concern while moving to the cloud. And we will show you in the subsequent slides how this can be achieved to make your solution secure, though it is running in the cloud. Along with these benefits, which are day-to-day very useful for developers and DevOps engineers, we also see the benefit that repeatable. Once things are automated, you can just reuse your solution and use it in any project, so it's easy to deploy. And as a DevOps engineer, easy to maintain, because if I see something going down, I just get to know it from monitoring, and then I can just fix it before developer complains to me. So it's very easy to maintain. And once it is automated, it's reusable. That's the second point. And when your CI infrastructure is very robust and reliable, that makes developers work very efficiently, because developers' time is very expensive in any software development project. So we need robust and reliable CI infrastructure. So let's see how each of these can be achieved further. So self-healing. I'll just summarize again what self-healing. So self-healing actually allows the system to discover this is not working correctly. And when it finds it's not working correctly, without any human intervention, it allows to make necessary changes, recover the system back to normal in a couple of minutes. So in case of Jenkins Master, how it looks, we have Jenkins Master running in the cloud, which is part of autoscaling group, which makes sure that we always have one Jenkins healthy instance running in the autoscaling and available via load balancer. Then we have EBS, which is Elastic Block Store, which is a managed service from Amazon, which is a persistent volume, which is reliable, and which can be attached to EC2 machine. And these two things are completely separate. So EC2 machine knows the existence of EBS, but EBS doesn't care when the Jenkins master goes away. So let's say in the cloud something is going wrong and your Jenkins master, for some reason, it is unhealthy. So it's going away. So what happens next? Jenkins master is gone and EBS is still staying as it is in the cloud. Now we know that Jenkins master is part of our autoscaling group. So it is going to check. I don't have any healthy instance. Get one more. So it will try to come up with a new machine. So new Jenkins master machine comes up, and then it tries to reattach to the same EBS configuration. So it gets all the configuration back, and the system is back in a couple of minutes. So this is how the self-healing. We are not interfering anything in the middle here, so it comes automatically. So this is what self-healing we implemented. So how did we implement this? So main thing for self-healing implementation is EBS, Elastic Block Store, which is SSD or HDD backed, and all the snapshots are encrypted. This is the main benefit. In case of any compromise of EBS, the EBS become useless, because if it is encrypted, nobody can use it. And EBS is a managed service, so let's make use of it. And the availability of EBS is finite, so which is quite much reliable and stable in case of while losing the Jenkins. And I think developers can still cope up with 6 to 8 minutes of wait for Jenkins coming up compared to number of hours. So in the next slide, we will see how the self-healing, in the next slide, we will see the second benefit of highly scalable. So we already saw Jenkins master is the only interface to the user. It is going to get all the build requests, run the build, give the artifacts back. So it's the whole one and only one contact for the user. So imagine all the load coming to the master. It cannot cope up. So we need number of people or number of slaves who are going to run all those jobs. So in the right-hand side, you see when there is a build request, new slaves or new agents are coming up. And then Jenkins master becomes more powerful. So it can cope up with the increasing load. If we have 50, 100, any number of builds during release time, then we have multiple agents coming up. And they come on demand. So once the build is done, they are going to get terminated automatically. So we don't need to worry about the cost. So they come, they do the job, they go back. So master only stays all the time. So there are two types of ways where we can achieve scalability. One is vertical scaling, and second one is horizontal. So in vertical scaling, we need to upgrade the machine to the better configuration. To do that, we need to interrupt manually and stop the service, which we don't want when Jenkins is running. So horizontal scaling allows me just to add extra node on demand. And horizontal scaling perfectly fits here to make the system highly scalable. So because of high scalability, no developers has to wait in the queue, and multiple jobs can be run concurrently or in sequential, depending on the project requirement. So the next slide, we will see how the configuration of scalability looks like when it is used Elastic Compute Cloud. So first thing, Amazon machine image. So whenever you want to have your slave of a particular configuration or a particular OS platform, you need to choose your AMI, so which is Amazon machine image, so the bootstrap of OS. So this you can bake using the creation of AMI can be done using tool like Packer, or there are multiple other tools, whichever fits for the project. And then next block shows spot instance. So spot instance allows to use the unused EC2 instances in your account with the discounted price. So for cost benefits, it's always a good choice to use the spot instances for your slaves or agent. And we are always worrying who can access all these slaves and machines coming up. So security groups in cloud, they allow us who all can access. We can always restrict the IP ranges, so only developers over the VPN inside the office network we can access, so they can be secured. And then labels. So we always can label the, if we have multiple 10 or let's say 20 slaves or agent, we can always label them along with the, okay, this is for application one, this is for database check. So you always can configure your build jobs with the restricted labels. So this gives a flexibility to use the particular slaves or agent for your particular jobs. And then number of executors. So number of executors is basically, it allows to run concurrent build on the same slave or agent. So how do we choose the number of executors? So this number depends on the number of CPU cores available on your machine. So if machine is really low configuration, you cannot have 10 executors on that. It's going to make slow. So you need to really have a powerful machine to make the concurrent jobs. So executor depends on the machine configuration. And this is can be changed or configured in very easily. And then instance cap. So when you have a software development project running, you get fair idea how many slaves or how many parallel builds you are going to have. Let's say 10, 20, or 50. It can be always changed to 100 or any number. But you get a fair idea, and you can always configure that maximum cap limit, what you want to have. And the last one, but very important to mention, that all these Jenkins slaves are also having identity access management profiles. So their permissions, their accesses to the resources within your environment are restricted. So it's for security purpose, it's really important. So this is very easy configuration, which allows the scalability to cope up with the increasing load. So security, while moving to the cloud, why should I move to cloud? And then security is really a big concern, because source code, which is the most valuable asset, which is intellectual property of a company, if any compromise happens to the data loss or to the source code, then it is going to get undesirable consequences to the organization, which we don't want. So security becomes real crucial here. So how can we secure your infrastructure when you are moving to the cloud? So first thing, principle of least privilege. So when you are giving permissions, make sure that eliminate as much as possible. So give the permissions which are required to do your job. So this helps to minimize your surface attack, and which gives only required permissions. So this is really helpful while minimizing the permissions in any infrastructure. And then second, we used Amazon Web Services identity access management roles and policies. So this is second important thing, which is you can granularize the permissions depending on the resource which you want to access. I don't want my Jenkins to access all the buckets in the account. So we can always restrict those permissions. and who can read the Jenkins. So you can always assign the roles and users. So this is for security, you can granularize the permission. And then in architecture, we already saw encrypted elastic block storage and S3 backup. So these both are encrypted. So this doesn't allow anything to make useful in case of any compromise. So they are encrypted. And last point is, if in your organization, if you're using lightweight directory access protocol, which is a standard for authentications and Active Directory, so you can integrate your whole system along with that. So you want to make the accountability, who is logging, and you don't want to have a, let's say if there are 50 team members or let's say 20 team members, you don't want to maintain 20 different credentials just for using Jenkins. So you can always integrate your Jenkins dashboard with Active Directory services or any other LDAP, whatever you have in your organization. So this makes it secured and you can always keep track of logs also. So these are the main security aspects we took care while setting it up. So next slide, we are going to see how the whole creation can be automated using Amazon Web Services CloudFormation. So CloudFormation is the JSON or YAML-based template, which allows to automate the infrastructure. The whole template is available on my GitHub account, but we are going to see in detail snippet of the code, what I would like to discuss today. So let's have a look how the CloudFormation works and how did we do that. So this particular screenshot, so if you see in the right side, we have resources. So this is the sample example of how CloudFormation works. So CloudFormation is JSON or YAML based, and it is used to create, it can be used to create infrastructure as a service. So you just provide what you want and you can create it easily using the template. So right side you see EC2 instance creation, so Elastic Compute Cloud. You want to have one EC2 machine, so it gives you the construct. You need to have some parameters which are shown in the left-hand side. So parameter is something which varies account to account or project to project. So let's say you want to create EC2 instance. It can be of T2 small size. It can be C3 large. So it depends on how you want. So left-hand side of the screen, it shows all the parameters which you need to pass externally, which varies. And the right-hand side shows the creation of any resource what you want to create. So in the resources, just to highlight a bit there, we have different kinds of resources like VPC, subnet, IAM roles and policies. So all these resources are having dependency on each other, and all these resources need some kind of parameters. So they can be passed from the parameter section. Yeah. This diagram shows a design, high-level design template of Jenkins Master, EBS, Autoscaling Group, and ELB. So we are going to see how can we implement automation of this in the subsequent slides. The first one is parameter, which is very important. When you try to set up Jenkins infrastructure for your account, you need to have which OS I'm going to use, which Amazon machine image I'm going to pass, which, what key pair I'm going to use, which network. So all these are very basic things which you want to parameterize externally. Then second one. So first thing, we are going to create EBS volume, which is encrypted. So encrypted EBS volume is created. So when you are creating EBS for the very first time, so you need to create volume completely from the scratch. But in case of recovery, you want to reuse EBS volume, which is existing. Then in that case, you can check the condition. Do I want to use or do you want to create new one? So once EBS volume is created, you are going to attach that to your EC2 machine. In this case, it will be Jenkins Master. And once it is attached, it waits for some time to get it attached. And then once it is attached, it is going to create the file system if it is not present existing. So once it is created, after creation of the EBS volume, file system check will be done. And once file system is created, it's going to mount the EBS volume on mount point. So this all happens during the bootstrapping, step by step. So plugins are a main thing what we use in Jenkins infrastructure. And all the plugins, there are some thousands plus plugins. So you can install all the plugins, whatever you need during the bootstrap of the Jenkins master, along with the versions, whatever you want. And in this example, we use Jenkins as a Jenkins master as a Dockerize. So you need to build the Docker image, fetch the Docker image, what version you want. All these things can be done sequentially during the bootstrap. You can also install whatever softwares you need or tools you need on the Jenkins master. So this is all part of bootstrapping. Next one. So this is a solution what we started with, and it was really helpful for us. But definitely, no solution is perfect, and there is always a chance, and there is always things to which you want to further improve. So we would like to share a few things which we would like to improve further on, and which is, I think, helpful for you also. So we already saw with the self-filling, we get the Jenkins master back in a couple of minutes. It takes around 6 to 10 minutes, because new machine is coming up, and bootstrapping is going to happen. So it takes 6 to 10 minutes. This works for some companies, some projects, but let's say you cannot wait for 6 to 10 minutes also. Then you need some more further improvement in that time. And how can we achieve that? So this design shows architecture for to make this time better and smaller. So how can we achieve this? So to achieve this, we can set up 2 Jenkins master node, Jenkins master, which is one is active, second one is passive, and both the Jenkins master node are sharing the file system, which is Elastic file system from AWS. They both are sharing the system. So EFS is a managed AWS service, and it allows concurrent access from multiple EC2 instances. So they both are sharing the system, so they both can keep up with each other. To make this available via load balancer, in this architecture, we are using HAProxy load balancer, which is an open source load balancer. I would like to mention why we cannot use here AWS Elastic load balancer. Because Elastic load balancer evenly distributes the load to the available healthy instances. But Jenkins, by design, it supports only, we can have only one Jenkins master machine. Because it is going to share everything to the EFS, to the file system. And we need the second passive node just to make sure that whenever there is a change in the file system, passive node has to keep up with it. And to catch that, it needs to rebuild the service. So when it rebuilds, it takes a couple of seconds. So that's the reason we need 2 Jenkins master node running. In case of any failure, second master node is always ready to take over during the failure. So in this setup, HAProxy load balancer is making sure that it routes the traffic to only active node, and when something goes wrong, it going to the passive node, and whole configuration is available immediately. There might be a case HAProxy load balancer is going to point to the passive node, and it is in the process of restart of the Jenkins service. But it is not going to take minutes, it is going to take just a couple of seconds, because it's just a restart of Jenkins. So this is improvement of time from the self-filling, what we can get to achieve the high availability. Along with the high availability thing, there are some more further things we would like to improve. So automating high availability is definitely one thing which we want to improve the time. Then second one is OS level LDAP integration, whatever you have. So whenever we debug, we try to SSH to the machine slave. So we want to keep the accountability, who are doing SSH, what all changes we are doing. So for that, you need to have LDAP integration. And imagine if there are 20 team members in the team, you don't want to have 20 accounts in the bootstrap, which are creating 20 times. Sometimes in between the project, people are leaving, some are joining. You don't want to restart your Jenkins all the time with this just because of the users changing. So if it is integrated to your corporate LDAP or corporate AD services, then it's easy to manage. Then we have all the backups running and getting stored into the S3 bucket. And so these backups are encrypted, but you don't want to have anyone to get just accidentally delete the S3 backups or accidentally delete Jenkins master. So we can always have a multi-factor authentication, which is which is set up and configured on S3 bucket so that deletion and Jenkins master cannot be terminated accidentally. And then logs. Something goes wrong. You want to know why, what went wrong. So logs are really important for any build jobs. In case of master get terminated, why it got terminated. So if it is integrated with CloudWatch or Logstash or Splunk, whatever logging tool you are using in your company, it can be integrated. Then logs are always useful, and you can read the logs in the nice, beautiful dashboards, what went wrong. So we already have EBS, S3, they are encrypted, but we also would like to have instance-level encryption. So there are some Linux utilities, Linux Unified Key Setup, which can be used to do the hard disk encryption at the instance level. Even IP table-based firewall protection we can use. So these are like hardening security further to make the infrastructure more robust and more reliable. So these are some of the improvements we would like to improve further. And then demo, we are going to show a live demo where we have an infrastructure setup, and we are going to simulate a failure in an infrastructure, and it should self-heal automatically without any human intervention.
In this demo, we are going to see how self-healing Jenkins works. So let's go to AWS dashboard. So Jenkins infrastructure is set up using Amazon Web Services. Let's have a look at Jenkins master. So as you see, this is Jenkins master machine, which is having private IP address and which also has some volumes attached here. So let's have a look at volumes. So this particular volume, which is ending with 10D, is attached to Jenkins master, as you see here, attachment. And let's check the load balancer, which is in front of Jenkins master. So as we see, Jenkins master is in service and it's healthy in this external load balancer. Let's try to connect to this load balancer. So I'm going to open the Jenkins tab. As you see, this is the load balancer. I have username password here. So we are in the Jenkins dashboard. So what we are going to see in this demo, we are going to terminate Jenkins master. We are going to simulate a failure in infrastructure, and we will see how Jenkins master comes back automatically. So before terminating Jenkins master machine, we'll just create one demo project here, and let's try to save it. So this is just for demo. Back to dashboard, and we'll just run this project, and let's see. So the project is run and the latest status is running. Now let's go to dashboard, EC2 dashboard again, and let's try to terminate EC2 instance forcefully. So we will simulate a failure in infrastructure. So let's terminate. As soon as Jenkins master is getting terminated, we can see in the load balancer there is no machine register, and when we try to go to dashboard, this is unavailable. So what's going to happen now? New master machine is going to come automatically. As you see, the old master machine is shutting down, and let's have a look at what happens to the volume. If you remember, the volume ID was ending with 10D and it is still present. It is persistent volume. So let's wait for new master machine to come back. It's going to take a couple of minutes. As you see, the master is terminated, new machine will come up. So in meanwhile, when new Jenkins master is coming back, we can have a look at our infrastructure, how we set up using CloudFormation. So as we see here, to spin up Jenkins, we need to have a basic infrastructure in place, VPC, subnet, and some basic security groups. And to have Jenkins, as you see, all the resources of Jenkins infrastructure are created using AWS CloudFormation. And as you see, parameters can be passed here, and the resources are created in the resource constraint. So how are we saving the second level of backup? So let's go to S3 bucket. And let's go to the backup bucket. So as you see here, all the backups are synchronized using duplicity. And benefit of duplicity is it encrypts the backup when it is stored in S3, and the backups can be done periodically by doing only the delta changes, and also we can run full backup weekly basis. And this backup we can recover anytime by using simple duplicity commands. So this is second level of defense when something goes wrong with EBS. And let's have a look at IAM rules and permissions. So we are using identity access management to keep Jenkins permissions. So let's see, let's look for Jenkins role. As you see, this is Jenkins role, and there are various different managed policies which we are using in this role, so that Jenkins have permissions to the required resources. In meanwhile, let's see what is the status of Jenkins master now. As you see, new Jenkins master is coming and it's initializing. It takes a couple of minutes because new instance is going to start and bootstrapping is going to happen with the same user data what we had in previous Jenkins master. And in this process, it's also going to reattach the volume what we had before to restore or the configuration back. So let's wait for a couple of minutes for master to get initialized. In meanwhile, I would like to still check the load balancer. So as you see, instance is already there, but it is out of service because it is still initializing, and it will do some health checks. And once it finds healthy, it's going to get in service. So let's wait for a couple of minutes, and we can see if the volume is already attached. So I think I should go to volume. So as you see, it's getting attached to the master. Let's see. So it's already attached to new Jenkins master, and it just initializing. So let's wait for a couple of minutes. It takes 6 to 10 minutes for new Jenkins master to initialize and bootstrap and reattach the volume. So now very soon it should be healthy in load balancer. Still out of service. It already finds the instance count 1, but it is yet to do the health checks. Let's wait. So, let's see here. And here are we can have a security groups which will allow access to Jenkins master only from required IP ranges from over the VPN or from office network, or so it depends on the project requirement. So as we see, Jenkins master is initialized completely and its check is okay. So let's check the load balancer. Okay, so it's healthy and it's in service. So we should be able to reach Jenkins dashboard again. So we are there. And as you see, the most recent job what we created just before terminating Jenkins master machine is also present there. So all the configurations, if you go to Jenkins and you see all the configuration in the configure system. All the configuration is recovered and nothing is missing here. So self-healing Jenkins helps us to recover a Jenkins master back in couple of minutes with all the configuration, and we don't lose any data. So this is the benefit of self-healing Jenkins when we move it to cloud. Thank you.
Maybe while we troubleshoot that, I can ask a question.
Yep.
Cool. So thanks, I've been getting a lot of them in here. First one I wanted to ask was, where did it go? Oh, did you consider using a management tool like Kubernetes to spin up the Jenkins slaves on demand?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So we started, we had a Jenkins on-premise and we started moving it to the cloud. So Amazon we chose because that was already in place and that was the first choice. It was the first option, but we are going to, I tried a little bit with the Kubernetes setup, and it's very much possible to have a self-healing Jenkins setup on the Kubernetes cluster as well. So it's very easy to do there too.
Cool. What about what health checks or what criteria do you use for the health checks of a Jenkins master?
For Jenkins master, we have port 8080 open, and then you can check the endpoint, whatever is, so whether your load balancer is always available to the end user, so you can do that periodic checks.
Okay. I'm going to ask an audience question. Is anyone here working for CloudBees? Cool, then I feel okay asking this. Why have you considered using the CloudBees Jenkins Enterprise?
No, it's very expensive.
That's why I asked first.
That's why.
All right, and,
because high availability solution is easily available in CloudBees, but it's expensive. You want to have something which works with the cost.
I think that's totally fair.
Yeah.
How do you safely upgrade plugins? Do you do security scans?
Yes. Plugins are always challenging Jenkins master. Sometimes you upgrade your Jenkins version and then it doesn't work with the plugins. So with plugins, you have to be really, really specific which version works with the setup, and scanning is always important on that.
All right. How does the self-healing cope with situations where the Jenkins configuration on EBS got corrupted?
Okay, so when it gets corrupted, the first level of EBS is gone, then you need to resurrect your system from S3 backup. That's our second level of backup.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think we have time for one more, although I heard the other group clapping.
Mm-hmm.
All right, here's a seems a little bit more tricky. Wasn't it possible to use GitLab plugins or GitLab API calls instead of VPC pairing?
Could you please repeat the question?
Happy to.
Yeah.
Wasn't it possible to use GitLab plugins or GitLab API calls instead of VPC pairing?
It is possible, but I think VPC pairing is more secured when you have two systems running in the VPC, which are sitting in the AWS network.
Cool.
Yeah.
Can we do one more round of applause?